We're back with the Tech Policy Grind. I'm Rima Musa, and I'm a fellow with the Internet Law and Policy Foundry, the organization where the next generation of tech law and policy professionals convene to write, think, and talk about the web, technology, and disruptive innovation. This is the Tech Policy Grind, the Foundry's podcast where we chat about what's going on in the world of tech policy. Welcome back. This week, we're on a roll with our fellow highlights series as we plug through season 4 of the show. Can't believe we're approaching the final quarter of the year already. So weird. But what's not so weird is our guest today, David Morar. He's everywhere in tech policy and a great person to know and follow in the space. He's also a current Foundry Fellow and a wonderful human being overall. Our fellow Highlights series host, Mary Bagdasarian, gets into his background, his experience in internet governance and as an ICANN fellow, and the art of not self-eliminating. Hope you enjoy.
Hi, David, and welcome to Tech Policy Grind. How are you feeling today?
Hi, Mary. I'm doing pretty well.
So to kick us off, tell us about yourself and how did you find yourself in the tech policy space? David, for everyone's awareness already, has been at so many places, has done so many things, and I just want him to take it away.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it. Thank you. The way that I came to tech policy was I wanted to do a graduate school in the U.S. I'm originally from Romania, and I wanted to come to the U.S. and study so that I could then get a job and then pursue the ultimate dream, which hilariously has nothing to do with tech policy, and it's comedy. So I did my master's, and it was in international affairs. And back then, I was very interested in something called soft power, you know, looking at science diplomacy. From then on, kind of had a bit of an interesting trajectory, going through a couple of different academic PhD programs during both my PhD and afterwards. I've done kind of a little bit of everything almost in the tech policy space, partly because I wanted to experience and learn and figure out new things in new places, but also because as a foreigner in the United States, you are constrained by visa issues. It took a while to get to where I am now. I am a senior policy analyst at the New America's Open Technology Institute and an affiliate with a couple of universities in the US and globally.
So you worked on a lot of issues that are more global, but you also are based in DC and you work on also like US focused issue areas. I would love for you to maybe reflect a little bit on like the differences or similarities that you see between like the policy making, tech policy areas in US versus globally, and which one do you think makes more sense to you personally?
I would say there's a lot of differences. The most obvious one is free speech. The First Amendment of the U.S. Constitution very much colors a lot of the discussions in the U.S. Policy circles. At the same time, the conversation about allowing freedom of speech also takes place in Europe, but it does so under completely different perspectives and within completely different, boundaries, I would say, than in the US. Because I studied in the United States and because a lot of my work has been kind of US centric, it changed a little bit of my trajectory. So my work on during my PhD focused, like I said, on internet governance, internet policy, but it looked at it from a perspective of private governance and sort of, you know, focusing on institutions at an international level that are inherently multi-stakeholder. And that is something that isn't necessarily or at least wasn't, you know, when I was starting my PhD about a bit more than 10 years ago, wasn't necessarily a focus in the EU. What it meant for my research was, oh, I am interested in this unique, different perspective because that is a way to go past the limitations of a First Amendment, right? Or is a way to push a lot of the governance, for good or bad, outside of government and into the hands of other stakeholder groups. That's the biggest difference I would see. Then we're also kind of looking at differences in terms of process and in terms of politics, right? And you know, the EU, for all of its let's say quirks, in terms of bureaucracy and in terms of the very large apparatus of institutions in the EU, it also is a lot more productive than the United States at the federal level in terms of legislation.
I always find the comparative perspective so fascinating. There is a lot to gain from seeing that there is another perspective which is not inherently wrong or bad. It's just different. And then you can just understand maybe that will help you make your measures or policies just stronger and better. I just hope we get more of this perspective. I think you already mentioned that you worked on so many, you know, like a variety of tech policy issues. But I would love to know which ones you are working on right now and which ones maybe you consider to be closer to your heart that you stopped on them at this point, you know?
Yeah, no, for sure. Yeah, no, thank you. I mean, I will say I've seen the shift. Just kind of coming back a little bit to your response to my response, the previous one, I will say I have seen a shift, and that shift has been that, you know, at least in the EU, there has been more openness to these technology, to these private governance perspectives that are weaved into a co-regulatory mechanism in legislation. So I definitely see that as a huge positive. To answer your question on the topics themselves that I focus on right now, I would say primarily my job is to focus on issues of privacy at the federal level in the United States. At the same time, kind of like keeping an eye out on what's happening around the world, obviously, you know, specifically in the EU, but also in other jurisdictions as, you know, the time is available. But I'm also interested in and I'm doing work in issues of platform accountability and you know, algorithmic governance issues, which kind of spill in a little bit more to the topic du jour, which is AI. Everybody's talking about AI governance. Everybody's talking about, you know, how to rein things in, how to pause things, how to think about, you know, catastrophic, harms, which, you know, the latter two are not necessarily my positions, but that's what the discourse is on. So you have to, engage. And from my perspective, I think those two pieces of privacy and platform and algorithmic accountability feed in directly into the AI conversation. So, you know, being able to tackle those two things first then allows you to get a better sense of real and useful policies for finding a better way to regulate and govern artificial intelligence, however we define artificial intelligence. So those are my areas that I'm working on right now. I'm also obviously interested in, because of my research and because of my involvement with one particular organization in internet governance, And for those that don't know, that the folks that use the phrase internet governance, what they mean is, I mean, obviously there's a lot of folks that mean different things, but the folks that are in my area use internet governance to mean the processes and institutions of governance that deal with the international, global implications of the internet. The most obvious example of that are institutions like ICANN, the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, IGF, the Internet Governance Forum, IETF, the Internet Engineering Task Force. Most of these tackle issues at the infrastructure layer. And, you know, that's kind of an area that is a little bit more prone, let's say, to having global cooperation than something at the software level or at the application level, or even more specifically on content. So that's an area a bit to the side, not fully related to or not fully in my purview for work, but definitely something that I'm interested in and something that I've been involved in for a good amount of time now.
Yeah, I mean, so many things to think about these days, but AI definitely is the buzzword everywhere. But as you mentioned, ICANN, and that was also something I wanted you to talk about. I think there is this maybe not so much anymore, but in general, I feel like there is the fear of, you know, people from humanities sector to go anywhere that is more technical. But I think we bring something different to the table. And I know that you've been involved with ICANN for a while. So I guess I would love you to maybe reflect, how did you find that experience and the journey? And if you have any tips for people that would love to learn more or just be more engaged, but just are a bit too subconscious about it.
For sure. Yeah, no, thank you. Yes, I mean, I would say that the internet governance institutions, the international internet governance institutions, are unique because it's not the same way as, you know, the way that most people think about international politics or governance, which is you have all of these countries coming together making decisions, right, in a multilateral perspective, in a multilateral scheme or mechanism. These organizations, these institutions in the internet governance space are run through, I would say, different flavors of the same thing, which is multi-stakeholderism, which means that if you are interested, if you have the availability, and if you have the and if you're able to make both the time commitment and the commitment to kind of learning and thinking through a lot of these problems, you have the opportunity to end up making decisions, or, you know, being in the room, having a voice on decisions that are crucial for the infrastructure of the internet. And that can sound like a big word, and it can sound like something that is, you know, hard to comprehend. But the easiest way to frame it basically is from the name. So the ICANN has two N's. It's the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers. So those two N's, I think, are the easiest way to explain to somebody that is the domain name system, which is the DNS, which is the names and the numbers. And the names are the top level domains. So everything that's to the right of the dot, right? So if it's like, .com or .ca, or, you know, .info, or if we're looking at the newest ones like .ninja, right? All of these are top level domains, and they're not in any way kind of a Wild West. There are folks that make policies and decisions downstream from the or rather upstream from the user, but there's a lot of policy decisions that are made. And it's, again, it can sound very abstract and very complicated, but if you're in any way interested, ICANN has a lot of explainers on its website. It has a lot of opportunities for folks to engage virtually. And there's also an opportunity, which is how I got involved with ICANN, for something called the ICANN Fellowship, which means that, you know, you apply through this. Now it's a bit more intense, or rather intensive, process. But you apply, and if you get selected, you know, ICANN will send you to wherever in the world that meeting is happening. And usually the ICANN meetings happen around the world. They will send you, they fly you out, they'll put you in a hotel, they'll give you a little bit of money to, you know, to make sure that you don't starve. And then they give you opportunities to understand what ICANN is, what it does, how you can get further involved. The fellowship is the best way, if you're even loosely interested in this area, to join, right? And there's, because it's a true multi-stakeholder structure, you know, and this is not a value judgment, true in the sense of it has input from multiple stakeholder groups. You can join the business constituency, or the non-commercial user constituency, or the IP constituency, or you can join something called the at-large groups, right? The regional at-large organizations. So there's many ways you can get involved. There's many ways you can participate past the original fellowship, and you can come back to ICANN as a fellow three times throughout your time, and different, and you know, once you're in it, you then are kind of dropped into the whole ecosystem of internet governance. And I would say that while ICANN is the most intense because it has so many different pieces, it's also the most approachable and the easier to kind of then translate your interest into other different internet governance institutions. I don't know if that has actually made people interested in the space, but I have to say it's a really great area to be involved in, especially if you're part of civil society. We're always looking for new folks to get involved, new folks to express positions, and it's not necessarily a US-centric position that is kind of there or needed. There's a lot of folks from around the world. There's a lot of folks from Africa. There's a lot of folks from around Asia. There's good contingents of folks from Latin America, Europe as well, and some from some folks from the United States as well. But it's a truly global experience.
Yeah, I would just add that this is also a place to find community, I think. Yeah. And in addition to the fellowship program, there's also, if you are a student, you can apply to the Next Gen at ICANN program, which is also like an immersion initiative. And I have been part of that, and it was really interesting to, you know, learn more about ICANN and just understand all the mm-hmm. acronyms and just meet more people.
Yes, there's always four, five, six letter words that you always have to remember what the thing is. Yeah. So.
Yeah. And then full disclosure, everybody struggles with that. So that is also not something to feel bad about. But yeah, I mean, you have been in different roles, and mm-hmm. you've been like part of different stakeholder groups. And you also, I think, have a very interesting career path in terms of that, like, this is a very subjective personal opinion, but I feel like most of the people in this space are either lawyers or people with technical background, like majority. You have a political science background, and then you were in academia and civil society and worked globally, and you know the EU side, and then you are trying to keep up with the rest of the world and then focused on US. So I guess, yeah. I'll ask you my favorite question, which is, what were the best and worst pieces of advice that you were given when you were trying to figure out your way into this space, or just like the next step in your journey in the tech policy space?
Yeah, no, thank you. I mean, that's a big question. I would say, some of the best pieces of advice have just been to not give up when it feels overwhelming, but also to ask for help, to reach out to folks that, are, you know, have done these things for a while, or if they haven't, have at least a similar, perspective or outlook to yours. And, you know, in tech policy broadly, I think, is a bipartisan or nonpartisan, however you want to call it. It's a friendly environment, and is a space where it's not difficult to form a community if one is not already there for you, and is also not difficult to kind of be able to engage and be part of discussions, even from an earlier kind of time in your career. So that, you know, don't give up, but at the same time, ask for help if needed. Definitely, you know, don't struggle by yourself. Was a great piece of advice. Another one has been to, you know, to never feel like things are outside of my not abilities, but outside of my outside of what I would see for myself, you know. So don't self
eliminate.
Don't self eliminate from positions, from conversations, from topics, because you feel like you might not have the right experience or expertise or perspective. Don't do that. Obviously, don't be a jerk and insert yourself into everything and get, you know, annoy everybody. But if your tendency is to say, well, I'm not there yet, or this isn't for me, or whatever, if that's your tendency, then I would say, what I was told is, and I would pass it on to others, is to not worry about it. Is to, you know, obviously be kind and be a good person, and again, not be a jerk about it. But you'll be amazed how open people are, how much you already know, and if you don't know, even just having the experience of going out for an interview, or, you know, being part of a conversation where you're not giving that much, you know, you're not like providing that much input, but you're listening and you're making connections. It's important, and it's very useful. And that, I think, was a great piece of advice. In terms of bad advice, I don't think I've gotten bad advice. Or if I have, I probably blocked it out. And just kind of gone with the flow. I'm trying to think. I don't think I've gotten bad advice. I think I've been very fortunate to have a lot of great mentors throughout the years. I've been fortunate to kind of end up with good friends that have, you know, steered me right, and also good colleagues to learn from, you know? So yeah, I don't think I've gotten bad advice in this space. I think maybe, you know, one or two people maliciously at one point were like, you should quit. But I didn't take that to heart.
Yeah, I mean, that's great. I mean, not the part that they were like, you should quit, but the fact that you didn't take it too hard. And thanks for sharing that. Yeah, I think to supplement this previous question, I will also ask you to share if there are like specific, I don't know, blogs or publications that you follow, or like podcasts or anything that you think will be helpful for people to just keep track of everything that happens in this space, like all the time.
Yeah, but, there's a lot happening. Yeah, I mean, I tend to, I remember because I was once doing a job interview for an internship or a fellowship, I don't remember. And I got a similar question to this, and completely seriously, without missing a beat, I went, well, you know, I have a very well curated Twitter feed. And that's obviously not an answer in an interview for a job where they're trying to figure out like who you read, what your interests are, what your headspace is. And unfortunately, you know, Twitter has declined since that has happened, since I said that almost 6 years ago. But you know, there's a lot of great outlets that publish, regardless of whether you agree with them or not, that publish good, really good stuff. I would say a few of them are Tech Policy Press. Another great outlet is Tech Dirt. There's always great analysis from the folks at the Brookings Tech. I can't believe I'm blanking. There's tech in all the names, so I always have to. I think it's called Tech Tank. That is, yeah, Tech Tank, at Brookings, you know, obviously a great, space to get a lot of information more on very specific areas, but, Lawfare, also, connected to Brookings is a great, space to learn. And while I was joking about it, I do think that there are folks that are very good at disseminating information on social media, whether it was Twitter before, or it's you know, Blue Sky or a Mastodon server now, you know, and that I think is more of a personal preference of who you want to follow. There's great folks on, you know, the right, the left, on, you know, EU stuff, US stuff, stuff in Brazil and in Australia and Africa, that you can kind of just slowly build up a great curated social media feed. I will also have to say, as a slight disclosure, I have published with all of the outlets that I just said are great, but that has not clouded my judgment. They're not great because they published my work. They were great before, and I was very fortunate that they published my work. So, you know, don't come at me in the comments for that. Those I would say are really great places. And you know, obviously, I'm missing a bunch that aren't always top of mind, or specifically aren't top of mind right now. But you know, places like Slate's Future Tense, which again, slight disclosure, I work for New America. Future Tense is a project of, is a co-produced project with New America and ASU and Slate. But there's a lot of great work being done in the space that you can catch up on. Morning newsletters are great. Politico Pro Tech has a great morning newsletter, Morning Tech. There's, you know, great stuff coming out of Axios with their Axios Pro tech policy vertical. There's so many places where you can get your information. And I think it's just up to finding a good rhythm for yourself, a good, you know, a good set of folks that you trust. because that's also important. And maybe even a good set of folks that you, you know, just generally align with. So,
yeah, I mean, I can totally relate to the Twitter comment because I think that would be my first instinct when I get this question too. And yeah, it's a bit sad, but yeah, having a good, like, well-curated Twitter timeline definitely was something that you need to work on, but then it works for you. But thanks a lot for sharing this. We will make sure to include them in the show notes for people to check them out. And I mean, this was great. Thanks so much for taking the time to just chat and share your perspective. Like, you see things on more, you know, local level and then global level, and then how things, like the dynamics and you know, the differences, and then how to get more involved. I think there is a lot to, like, take from your answers. But to close us off, I think I would just love to know what is next for you and what you look forward to right now in your career.
Sure. Thank you. I mean, first of all, thank you very much for having me. I'm, you know, honored to be one of the fellows that you're spotlighting. Really appreciate it. I'm excited for the work that we're doing at New America at OTI. I think there's going to be a lot of good stuff coming out in the next coming months on all the stuff that I've mentioned, and, you know, some work that my colleagues are doing that is outside of my sphere that I'm very excited for. And I think for me, it's next steps are continuing to do good work, you know, continuing to have a foot in the academic space, to do research that is at that level of, you know, professionalism, let's say, but also a bit detached from the day to day of tech policy, because I think that's also important to have and to do. And, you know, looking forward to whatever fun things are going to happen. And I'm putting fun in air quotes, whatever fun things are going to happen in the US and the EU in terms of legislation and other tech policy shenanigans that I feel like are definitely coming this year until December. So, you know, who knows?
There is never a dull moment in this space.
Absolutely not. Not even in August, when most folks are out, there's always stuff happening.
Yeah, I mean, it's intense, but also quite exciting. And I am also very excited for all the plans that you have. And thanks again for taking the time to chat with me, and looking forward to seeing, you know, all the things that you have in the pipeline realized, and hope to have, like, another chat down the line, and then we'll reflect on what happened in the meantime.
Thanks. Sure. Thank you. I appreciate it. Thanks a lot.
Thanks for tuning into this episode of the Tech Policy Grind. If you enjoyed the show, get in touch with us at Foundry Podcasts with an S at ilpfoundry.us, or leave us a review wherever you're tuning in. I'm Rima Musa, the host of the show, and this podcast wouldn't be possible without the help of our team at the Aronet Law and Policy Foundry. Thank you to Evan Enzer for editing this episode, Lama Muhammad, our social coordinator, Allison McReynolds, our accessibility coordinator, and Tim Lorden at the Aronet Education Foundation. See you next time.